and HD is rated M for mature audiences and contains nudity.
From the TCN9 studios, Sydney, the Channel 9 Show! With the current affairs, the Richard Carlton Experience, special guests Wayne Goss, Sally Stegall, and Peter Andre. And now our host for the night, H.G. Nelson and rampaging Roy Slaven.
Thanks very much indeed, Ian Taps Tabby. Thanks very much indeed, The Current Affairs. And thanks very much indeed, The Richard Carlton Experience. Hi there, consumers, and welcome to the Channel 9 Show on another Saturday night. And what an action-packed wheeze we have steaming on the hot plate here at the Channel 9 headquarters this evening. But before we suck it and see and jump into bed before that Easter rabbit does come hop, hop, hopping along, rampaging Roy Slaven, who or what has been sticking the head up out of the trenches down your end of the swamp this week, Squire?
Thank you very much, H.G. Nelson. George Michael.
Yes.
H.G. There's a lesson there. There's a lesson there for us all. Our tourists going overseas. Be careful in public toilets. Look, it does bear out, I think, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. That the observation of experiment changes the nature of an experiment. There's a poor bloke goes into a public toilet, not doing anything wrong, just there, you know, doing whatever he does. In a cubicle by himself, looks over his shoulder and sees a couple of blokes on the pier and over the top. Yeah. Well, obviously, especially if you're in show business, you're going to show off. You're going to put on an act. You're going to give them a bit of pizzazz. You're going to drop the trousers and get involved. And he gets pinged. The bloke did nothing wrong. Just as he's in show business. There's a lesson there for people in show business. Coming from Australia, for example. Going to London, going overseas.
Different mores.
You've got to understand the mores of the culture. You can't just swan into a toilet and do whatever you bloody will like.
Well, look, I was caught short at Wingard Station.
Well, who hasn't been?
I stepped in, I addressed the porcelain.
Yes.
And
was
a
there
person.
On the door?
There was. A person came in with a wooden hammer.
Yes.
And started banging on the pipes. I didn't think there was anything funny about that.
In a policeman's uniform?
Not quite. He had a beautiful red robe on and a horsehair wig on.
Right.
Was banging away, guilty as charged, my love.
Yeah.
That sort of gear.
Yeah, who got charged? You did.
Yes.
He got away.
He scarpered. Now, look, why I raise that is, I think public toilets owe it to tourists to put up a bit of a signage about local rules.
Do's and don'ts.
Yes.
Don't do anything if you're being watched.
That's right. Or showbiz can happen here.
Yes.
You know, if you want to.
Yeah, if you want to have a look, come on in.
Yes. And now on the Channel 9 Show, customers, can you welcome a man who did the impossible? This man escaped from politics and resumed a life as an ordinary citizen. Can you please welcome Wayne Goss? Well, Wayne, thanks very much for coming in. And obviously we have to talk about Queensland. Now, Queensland over the years have thrown up a lot of very interesting people on the political front. You know, there's obviously going back, there's Patrick Albert Field was one where I thought, hello, things happen differently in Queensland, going back many, many years. You know, Flo Jo, Tanty, what's his first name?
Frank.
Frank Tanty. Bruce Davidson, the bloke who wants to import the black rhino into North Queensland. Why is this? Why does, and disproportionate to anywhere else in Australia, why is it that Queenslanders are interesting politically?
Well, you note they're all conservatives that you've mentioned there.
But I could mention Bill Hayden. What a long distance he's travelled in his life.
He's not.
I thought he was going to come out for the Queen there at the Constitutional Convention.
He's not in the Labor Party anymore.
No, I understand that.
I'm not sure. I think it's the weather. I think there might be something in the water at Parliament House that affects people. Russ Hinze was another one.
Oh, yes, Russ Hinze. He's my favourite.
He was a special. Yes. No, I've had some experiences, some interesting experiences with most of them. But some strange people, I don't know what it is. Fortunately, I've escaped entirely any of the symptoms myself. So.
Yes. Yes. In fact, you're far too sane, really, for a long career in Queensland politics. I mean, I can say that here south of the Tweed, but, you know, obviously up there, if I wanted to go into politics, you know, it'd be a lot of this into the camera, wouldn't it? And weirder.
Well, especially these days, one of the last great reforms of the Goss government was to give television to Parliament, to the proceedings of Parliament. So at question time, they get to poke a lot of faces at each other now, and it's very, very edifying indeed.
How's Rob Borbidge going? How would you mark the Borb, say, out of 10?
Well, the Borb was a very good opposition leader, and he still does it very well.
Yeah.
I think, if I can just say to you privately here tonight, I think they got into office before they were ready.
Yes. Oh, that can't be right, can it?
A bit short on the policy side.
Yeah.
And now you've got, well, actually, we'll have an election in the next month or two. The sooner the better, because as soon as they have it, I'll be free.
Right.
But it's surprisingly close. It's on a knife edge.
Now, let's just talk about you for a moment, Wayne. You were a member of the Phantom Club, is that right? Were you
Absolutely,
a member? Yeah. What did you get? What did you get as a member? And how did you become a member? Did you just fill out the back of the form on the back of the Phantom Comics?
Oh, no. I had to win an election. And when I won the election, they made me a patrolman.
Yes.
Patrolman. When I won the second election, I got promoted to major.
Right.
And I got the boxer shorts, I got the tie, I got the lapel badge.
Yes.
I got a purple bust of the Phantom on my desk at home, and a few other knickknacks.
Did you get the rings? The ring that leaves the skull on the face, and the peace sign ring, the weird one?
No, I mean, I think the sort of people who get those are people who are into gimmicks, people who don't really respect the Phantom, the ghost who walks, and who would seek to... I see you covering up your fingers there.
No. I'm covering up the skull mark. What about old jungle sayings? Do you have any favourites? Mine was always, the Phantom is rough with roughnecks. Is there any that appeal to you?
Well, I like the one, when the Phantom moves, he moves.
Gee, I don't know that one. I know there's some nights the Phantom walks the streets dressed as an ordinary man. This is one of those nights.
Yes, in a purple jumpsuit.
Yes, that's right.
Sunglasses.
Yeah. Wasn't the film a disappointment? The recent film biopic on the Phantom. Very, very disappointing, I thought.
It was, actually. I went down to see the filming at the Movie World Studios down the Gold Coast and met Billy Zane.
Yes.
In fact, it was close to the end of my
tenure.
Tenure. I was nearly going to say reign, but you can't say
that. No, tenure.
We're all Republicans nowadays. And after we did the press conference together, the mob then assailed me about whatever the problems were in Queensland that particular day. And I then spoke to him afterwards, and he couldn't believe their treatment of someone as good-looking and as articulate as myself.
Yes. Now, just with the Phantom for a minute, going back, what I always liked were the offers on the back page, you know, the stamp collection and learn to play the guitar.
In
like
five minutes.
3 minutes. Did you go in for any of those?
No.
What, parents wouldn't allow it or never thought of it?
Talent deficiency.
All right. I think the stamp bloke had a patch. It was Captain Someone's bloody stamps or other. You were taught by George Negus at high school, weren't you?
Well, he was one of a number of teachers that I had to sort of break in.
Yeah. How did you find George? Did he wield the strap or the cane? How was he?
No, very warm and fuzzy, George.
Did he have the handlebar mustache then, or the long hair? Or
no facial hair. I mean, he was pretty trendy. Pretty trendy.
Was he a shorts and long socks man, or...
Yes, and we always thought it was odd with the leather patches on our ears.
What was his discipline? Was it manual arts or what?
I can't remember. I think it was English and geography and something.
He didn't make an impression.
Didn't make an impression on me at all, but I made an impression on him because many years later when he was interviewing me, he recalled me being a student at the school.
And you didn't remember him as a teacher?
Oh, vaguely. There were so many of them.
Right.
And they're all like George Negus.
Yeah. I read a quote of yours saying that you can't make money in politics. Is this true?
Well, no, that's not entirely true. Russ Hinz and some people made a lot of money.
Warwick Pear, essentially.
Yeah, well, that's politics and coal mining, I think. No, you can't make a lot of money in politics, but...
But I thought the last Prime Minister left a millionaire, didn't he?
Yeah, I'm not sure how much he had when he went in.
Well, the boy from Bankstown, led to believe he didn't have much at all. Surely you can make a bit out of politics.
Well, I suppose when you're getting all that advice from the people at Treasury...
Yeah. You'd be silly not to take it.
Yeah.
You'd be silly to hang on to your dollars if they were plunging in value, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Speaking of our former PM, you didn't like him much, did you? And probably still don't. What was the problem between you two? Why couldn't you smoke the peace pipe? What was the problem?
Well, we did smoke the peace pipe a number of times, but the problem with Paul was that when I disagreed with him, then I was a problem. When I agreed with him, I was a very good judge of character.
Yeah. But isn't it standard form for Queensland premiers to bag Canberra all the time? Isn't that the standard form?
Well, it does come with the instruction kit when you get sworn in. But yeah. I always got on pretty well with Bob Hawke. And I got on very well with Paul Keating quite a lot of the time. But it was sort of hot and cold. Paul had a bit of an attitude that if you agreed with him, as I said before, things were great, but if you didn't, then you were clearly wrong. And I got a bit of Irish in me, and we'd clash. And I remember one Premier's conference, we had a number of new Premiers. I think we had Richard Court, Dean Brown from South Australia.
Gee, all the biggies.
Jeff Kennett. Anyway, there was a few new ones there, and I was really dark in terms of being, this is our story, being done in on the Medicare deal. And words were exchanged, and I remember Paul saying something like, well, you were stupid, weren't you? In other words, to sign the agreement first. And I said, well, don't ever ask us to sign first again. And there were some colourful adjectives included in this exchange. And I remember looking around at my colleagues and they were looking at us and saying, these people are on the same side.
With your operation, have you got private health insurance at all?
No. I think the term is I self-insure.
Self-insure?
Yes.
Mm. Yeah, well, how does that work? What do you mean?
Well, we had a brawl with one of the health funds back in 1984. Ever since then, I paid my own insurance. And we're still in front, even with a brain tumour operation.
Right. So is Medicare the big problem in Queensland as it appears to be in New South Wales and Victoria?
Right across the country. Health costs are galloping away. And no government wants to pay for it. The federal government and the states both want to pass it to the other. Now, look, I'm trying to get out of politics.
No, I understand that. Well, I'll get you out of politics. Look, you spend a lot of time riding your bike and surfing. Now, what are you throwing a leg over? What sort of bike is it? What have you got? Have you got something with about 18 gears and does all the work for you? Alloy wheels?
Well,
and, you know,
21 gears.
21 gears?
Bloody hell. No. You wouldn't have to ride it. He'd do it himself.
Just say go.
Yeah.
Right. Take me to town.
What is it? Is it a Repco or is it a Speedwell?
I don't know.
You don't know?
It's a hybrid. It's a hybrid between a
Repco and a Speedwell.
No, between a road bike and a mountain bike.
Oh,
that's Melbourne Star.
Oh, it's a vehicle.
Now, Melbourne Star's what I had when I was a kid.
Now, you also ride a surf ski. What are you riding? Well, and where do you ride it?
Well, I ride it at Rainbow Bay was the last place, Stradbroke Island.
Yes.
And on Monday I'll be a little place just south of Yamba in New South Wales, where there's a couple of very good beaches there.
Yes. And what is it that you're riding? Do you think of upgrading? And if you say, what would you upgrade to?
Well, I've just upgraded about 3 or 4 years ago from a lightning bolt that I got at Byron Bay
to a
slightly shorter dart ski, which is terrific. If you're fit and you're skiing regularly, but when you're not, you tend to fall off a lot more.
Yes.
Colleagues used to say of you that you never had fun. Are you having more fun now?
Well, I feel a lot better. I mean, when I made the announcement that I was getting out of politics, got up and read it in the paper the next morning, I felt better. So I thought, well, that's a pretty good measure.
Yes. Now, Queenslanders tend to think the rest of Australia sees them differently, and the rest of Australia tends to think of Queenslanders different, Queenslanders as different. Is this a true position, a true reflection of the state of play?
Well, it is, sadly. I mean, one of the things I wanted to do when we got elected was to pull down the dingo fence and reintroduce Queensland to the rest of Australia. I think we made the place respectable again for a while, but seems to be going off the tracks again.
Mm.
Not permanently, I hope.
Right. Have you got a gun around the house at all, Wade?
No. No.
Oh, well, that's a good start.
And no. How are the plans?
Keep it in the car.
I'm one of those nice rats behind the wall of you there. Now, how's the business career going? You're talking about a third career. Working as a lawyer, then politics, and now third career in business. How are the opportunities coming your way?
Well, I've had a number of approaches. Some of them you wouldn't poke a 40-foot stick at, but there are some national companies that think I can actually do something for them. My plan is to get about 3, maybe 4 days work a week and leave the rest of the week to see what's left of the imagination I put on the shelf about 15, 20 years ago.
Yes. And get the surf ski out a bit more.
Oh, absolutely, yes, starting Monday.
Yes, well, look, Wayne, we could talk all night, but as you know, at the Channel 9 show, we do have commitments. Australia and Channel 9ers, can you thank Wayne Goss?
Since way back when, and this year it's gonna be a winner again. But I want you to know that all these years
we're still having fun.
Do you feel like public sex?
Pardon?
I think it's cheese time.
For sure.
Enter the dance, it's cheese time.
Yay, cheese time!
Could we start to have a cheese all around?
強積で入れて。
Leonardo's liquid dog butter. Available now.
Ever been taken to the cleaners?
Beginners, are you going to support your staff or are you going to lie down and die?
Elvis can fix it.
Hey, Tonka! The mole's had an idea.
Yeah, what is it?
Go tell him.
We kill wheels.
Yeah.
All new in 98.
You gave her an alibi?
Good guys, bad guys.
It's been you. It's a beautiful thing.
Tuesday, 9:30 on 9.
Time the Channel 9 show will bring you Olympic updates throughout the year in the build-up to the year 2000. And Roy One, Antonio Samaranch, is about to blow back into Sydney to have a look at how the preparations are going. And I understand that he's going to look at his digs while he's here for the big Olympic blow-up. And he's going to be billeted at Government House. He's going to unroll his swag down there at Government House near the Botanical Gardens, for those who are familiar with Sydney. Roy, is this a wise idea to put up one in Government House? What's the state of the old arc down there?
Look, I think it's a premature decision. I think one or a delegation from one should have a look at Government House to begin with. When I was there recently, there is rising damp.
Mm.
And I don't think that's good enough for one. There is falling damp. I know there's a fair bit of rot in the timbers, which isn't good either. And I think we've got to look at the whole question of how we should behave when one's here.
Yes.
When Juan is here, I think all the public have got to relate to him, behave in a way that makes him feel absolutely at home and comfortable. I think there should be a curfew, say, between 8 o'clock at night and 8 in the morning. And anyone seen out and about between those hours can be shot. Right. I think Holmes should be on Juan alert 24 hours a day. Mm. There can be a knock at the door, could be Juan. You should be ready for it.
Oh, yeah. How should they?
Have paella ready. Have food. Yeah. Have young people. Have anything ready there for him to do with as he pleases.
Yeah, right.
And if you see one, people should bend over the nearest object.
Or just an homage.
Just an homage. Yeah. If it's a table, you just bend over.
Yeah.
Obviously, with your head out, so you can say, well, this way, so you can say, yes, Excellency.
Yes.
With your head like that. And if there's nothing to lie on, say, a car boot or a table or something like that, you should just lie on the ground.
Oh, yes.
Prone.
Prostrate yourself.
And if you don't do that, you should be shot.
Yes. Now, look, can I
speaking of Government House, there should be somewhere, an area there, where one can watch people being shot.
Yeah.
He's no stranger to that sort of caper.
Now, Roy, two things that worry me about. Government House at the moment is opened on several days of the month for the public to stroll through.
Yes.
Worries me a little bit about that. Might catch one doing something that wasn't normally done.
Well, you've got to turn a blind eye.
In Government House, yes. You've just got to look away.
Yes.
The other thing is the outside
toilet.
Unlike
policemen in public toilets.
Indeed. Yes. I was just going to come to the outside toilet there. It's a fair step down to the outside toilet. There's a couple of corridors to get around, especially at night.
Yes.
Are we going to have to go in for...
We're going to have to put a tunnel.
Tunnel. Straight
an
out
an underground tunnel. A wan tunnel.
Yeah.
You know, with a conveyor belt.
Yeah.
So no matter where the bloke's sitting, anywhere in Government House, he just presses a button.
Off he goes.
Down to the conveyor belt. Up.
Yeah.
I think he's got to get off that chair and get under the toilet. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, no.
They can work that out.
Yeah,
they can have people there.
Yeah. Warming it.
Warming.
Move from one to the other. Then back
immediately get prone as soon as he comes in. Sorry, Excellency. Just bend over.
Yeah, in he comes.
In he comes.
Now, Roy, one other aspect of this is surely the officials, this is SOCOG, don't intend to bring Juan in through Mascot Airport because the bloke does travel with unusual gear, which would alert sniffer dogs and things like that, you know, and I'd hate an international incident to occur.
Yeah.
Because this would set back the Olympic movement and the SOCOG and the whole effort towards 2000.
What, Juan arrested?
Well, Juan busted in the toilet at Mascot with a couple of sniffer dogs and some sort of plain flower idea in the suitcase.
Yeah, sure.
Now, Roy, how are we going to deal with this?
There's always Bankstown Airport.
Yeah.
We could just earmark that for him. Well, bring him in by boat.
Oh, that's my theory. Bring him in by boat at night.
Because I know that area is pretty well protected at the moment. Just bring him in and he'd make him feel absolutely at home. As soon as he saw the dogs and the guards,
yeah.
It'd be, hello, I'm here.
Yeah,
I'm back.
I'm home.
I never want to leave again.
So Patrick's an unladen.
Of course they would.
Right, and when they play. Now, Roy, moving on, also we've got a huge ticketing problem. I did see this week, I think it was Cabinet.
Yeah.
The Federal Cabinet now want their whack of tickets, otherwise they're not going to fund the bugger.
How many do they want?
Well, I think they want a couple of hundred each, and they've got a few mates and so on. And then, of course, the International Amateur Athletics Federation boss, Dr. Nibolo.
Nibolo.
Isn't he a bit of a quack?
Nibolo.
Look, I tell you what, he wants 22,000 tickets.
22,000 tickets?
So between Cabinet...
For himself and his family.
That's right. Between Cabinet and Nibolo, there's going to be bugger all left for the people of Sydney.
Well, that's not really a problem. I don't know if anyone in Sydney wants to go.
No, that was my next point.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But I think the politicians should be able to get whatever they want.
Yeah.
We've just heard from Wayne, you can't make any money out of politics. I mean, you're only going to get into politics if you can get something out of it.
Yeah, true.
And if there's the hint, the sniff...
Of an Olympic ticket
or a couple of tickets, you'd have people queuing up to want to become politician.
Yeah, true.
No problems there.
True.
The other thing is, I've been out to Homebush. I've had a look at it with the Royal Easter Show in town. It's not bloody big enough.
What isn't big enough?
With the arenas, you should be able to sit... Millions of people there. Millions are going to want to go. I'm for a first in, best dress policy.
So just queue up.
You just queue up.
At, say, 4 in the morning.
Yeah.
And you get to see, a ticket in row Z.
Yes.
Because there'll be so many in front of you.
Yeah, politicians, you know, Juan, et cetera. What's his name?
Nibolo,
yeah.
Yeah, his lot. But, Roy, the other thing is we're now down to, I think, only 1 in 5 people in Sydney think they're going to get a ticket. I mean, it's a fluttering candle, the Olympic movement, over in the corner of some dressing shed out there, some agricultural pavilion. How are we going to get petrol on? How are we going to start a flame? How are we going to get a bushfire sweeping out there and consuming the city? Government house, mascot, the boat, and all that sort of stuff. How are we going to get that happening?
Well, we let Juan take over the arrangements, I think, H.G. Anyone who doesn't go to the Olympics will be shot.
Speaking of death, Nina's a very dear friend of the Channel 9 show dropped off the twig earlier this week. And the Current Affairs have been up night after night this week preparing a very, very special tribute.
This is Kenny Rogers' friend.
That's right, Kenny Rogers' friend. This tribute is to Tammy Wynette and everything that Tammy has meant to planet Earth.
Yes.
Here they are then, the Current Affairs with Stand By Your Man.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman, giving all your love to just one man. You'll have bad times, and he'll have good times, doing things that you don't understand. But if you love him, you forgive him, even though he's hard to understand. And if you love him, oh, be proud. After all, he's just a man. Stand by a man. Give him two arms to cling to and something warm to come to when nights are cold.
Of who's up and what's on.
Innovations.
Hi, and welcome to Innovations. Our guest in the studio this week is Dr. Charlene Reynolds from the Walker and Eliza Institute in Sacramento. Doctor, welcome to Innovations.
Thank you, Ian.
Doctor, your new book, The Eighth Sense, Speed Reading Without Looking. How does it work?
Good question, Ian. Ian, there is so much that we don't know. For 100,000 years, humans have relied on touch, taste, sound, smell, sight to understand the world.
Yes, well, this is true.
Well, I have proven that there is what I call in the book an eighth sense, which is the highway, if you will, from the outside to the inside.
Really? So if I were to give you this book to read, how would you use the sense?
As simple as this. There, I've read it. It's interesting.
That's amazing. But for our viewers, I think I should test you.
Fire away.
All right. On what page does chapter 6 begin?
Oh, that's an easy one, Ian. Page 206.
That is astounding. Dr. Reynolds' book, The Eighth Sense, Speed Reading Without Looking, is available right now by phoning the number on your screen. And I'll see you next week with more innovations.
Monica Trapaga, Australia's most loved children's television presenter. Last year, she met President Bill Clinton.
And all of a sudden, I looked up and I thought, oh my goodness, it's the president. And anyway, he smiled at me. And then he just dropped his trousers and exposed himself.
I'm Richard Culp.
I'm Liz Hay.
I'm H.G. Nelson.
And I'm Roy Slate. All these stories and more tomorrow on 60 Minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen on the Channel 9 show, please welcome Sally Steggall.
Sally Steggall is the name in the frame. Sally Steggall now lives with the fame. One thing that we know made the world want to know. Sally Steggall's story is the triumph and the glory.
Charlie, welcome to the show. And first up, let's have a look at the loop.
Okay.
Before we go to the footage, let's have a look at it. Whoa.
There we go.
Look at that.
Can we see that? Picture of this. Where are we? Where are
yes,
we
going? That's it. That's
oh, yeah,
good.
Right now. There. Oh, look, you can almost read the writing now, Roy.
Yes. The 18th Olympic Winter Games. Look at that. Isn't that fantastic? Nagano.
Look, I might wear it while we have the interview. Just going to show you what it was like. And let's remind people of how you got this. Here you are. You're in the green and gold. You're sliding down the snow here. You're busting your
great
way.
Great technique.
Indeed, the technique and the pictures, aren't they?
Sevens are a wonderful job.
That's right. And here's the final shot here. You're going, when I was there, I couldn't believe how fast you were going. Even though it looks as
slow. The camera slows it up, doesn't it?
Here you are. You get a chance to have a squiz at the scoreboard where the time is. And
you know
there
you've got
you are.
A medal.
Yes, you know, you've got a bit of a medal there. And then finally, this magic moment that you've worked so hard for over the last 4 years, where you stand up on the dais and some person comes along with you every month. Now, the circumstances of, you know, the competition with the Australian team, let's face it, hadn't had the best of luck and there was a lot of weight on you. Did you feel the weight of the lack of success when you were making that final run?
Yeah, there was pressure. I mean, you know, I think the biggest pressure was the beginning of the day, first run, you come out there, I'm there only for one day, one race, and I'd been hanging around for a week already, and you know, you hear the news of how everybody else is going and the pressure and expectations. So second run was just relief when I finally got down there and I'd held on to from being a contender in first run and then doing it again in second run, and it was just like, ah, finally. Thank you.
And the rest of the team, you know, obviously they were waiting for a bit of a breakthrough here in the medal count, and it seemed as though it would never come. Was there a palpable lift in the spirit of the team, even though Australia didn't go on and score any more medals?
Definitely. I think it's always a relief to get one piece of medal home, and it's a unique one in Australia as it is. We only went there with maybe a contender's chance of four or five people of medal hopes. So I guess getting one out of those four or five was pretty good odds. I think it's maybe a shame that I was right at the end of the Olympics, so I didn't lift the spirits before.
I understand. Now, when the Australian team goes there, it seemed from the coverage at least as though that there was an element, and it's a bit hard to divorce this from the world of skiing and the up-race ski and so on. There's a world of fun connected with the Winter Olympics, which the seriousness, which isn't captured in the seriousness of the Summer Games. Unfortunately, Kevin Gosper, one of the big choosers in the Olympic movement, came out and said we'd have to send a much smaller team next time and only focus on those sports where we could get a medal. So you look as though you might be our sole representative at the next Olympics. But is this fair, though? Is this the right way to go? Surely the reverse should be true, that we should send more and more people, get more and more interest in winter sports, more and more experience and so on.
No, it's tough. You can look at it both ways. Like in summer sports, I know the selection is very, very severe, and then you have very high medal expectation. But then again, the support's been there developing the programs for many years. Winter sports, we've had the Australian Ski Institute going for the last 4 years, and in that time, they've now gotten one medal. They've gotten me from being a 50th in the world ranked skier to being top 10 with a medal. I think that already shows the potential of it, and it's through that we'll get better, and I think cutting it is although many people say, it's pretty hard when the support's only been there very recently.
Yes. Do you think Kevin Gosper was being un-Australian in saying that, Sally? I think he was.
I think it's tough people. Yeah. Maybe it's a question of educate the people to know what Winter Olympics
are. Well, we've got to educate Kevin Gosper for a start and then let it filter down, trickle down style. The other thing is Channel 7's coverage. It seems to me, and Channel 7 make this mistake, I think, time and time again. They've done it with Patrick Rafter in the Australian Open. They've put too much pressure on individual performers. They put too much pressure on Kirsty Marshall, on Jackie Cooper, and almost too much pressure on you. Did you feel the pressure coming from Seven?
No, I was going to have fun.
When you won the medal, won the bronze, did you find Seven badgering you, saying, well, why aren't you crying? Do you feel emotional? How emotional? And they badgered your mum and dad, too. How do you feel? Are you feeling emotional? Why aren't you crying? And your mum and dad was just like, you know, business as usual, wasn't it?
There was a tear from mum at the medal ceremony.
Well, Seven didn't catch it, did they?
I missed the only one. It was the only one. Yeah, no, that was a funny experience. I mean, they definitely captured every single second of emotion there was to offer.
They were trying to squeeze it out, weren't they? Did they offer you something to, you know, to hold up to your eyes, to make induce tears or anything like that?
No, we didn't get that far. I mean, I tried to explain. There's no way I wanted to cry. It was sort of the happiest day of my life. So
why would you cry? Well, why did Sandy Roberts keep saying, why aren't you crying? You don't want to give us a tear.
No, well, I gave you all my smile, so that should do.
Yeah. Now, there's an old saying that you've got to be prepared to lose it to win it. Were you prepared to lose it to win it on that day?
Yeah. I think, you know, it was about, of the 50 people that started, I always knew that three people were going to walk away happy and the rest came for nothing. You know, might have enjoyed the experience, but we'll have absolutely nothing to show for it.
Yeah.
And I was prepared for that. I've been to two Olympics and I know what it's all about. I was finally there as a contender, really well prepared, and I thought, well, there's heaps of pressure and it can't get any worse, so I might as well enjoy it and take it for fun.
Something I noticed, a bit of a change, not so much in your style, but in your technique between, remember you were on our program on Club Buggery when we were on Channel 2. It seems to me, looking at you as we did the Channel 7 at Nagano, that your position on the skis is a little bit further forward than it used to be. Is this true, Zali, or not?
Yeah, our fitness training guru from Ian King in Brisbane, he got me doing plenty of work forward balancing and changed the position a little bit.
Yes.
You were really great to remind me of my falls last time.
That's
right.
So,
see, I've worked
well, you were too far back, weren't you? So you've got a little bit further forward, because after all, skiing is controlled falling, isn't it?
Well, your gravity. Controlled falling. Well, I guess, but when you saw the Olympics and you saw how many people fell, there was a lot of falling
happening. Well, that was uncontrolled falling. But what you do is controlled falling.
Yeah.
Now, can I suggest, and you do go faster when you're further up the nose of the ski, don't you?
Yeah, you definitely.
Why don't you go right up the bloody end? Why don't you really give it a shot?
Okay, I'll bring you down for a lesson of skiing and we'll see how you go.
Well, I'm just offering suggestions. I'm not suggesting I do that myself. Bloody hell, my skiing days are long gone. This is for the youngsters coming through. But will you go further forward?
No, I'm pretty much on the edge of it as it
is. Right. But speaking of Australia and the Winter Olympics, look, I have a dream. Call me crazy if you like. I just love the whole Winter Games experience.
Yeah.
And I believe on the evidence of what Seven showed us of Nagano,
yes,
that Australia can do it.
We can dominate.
And we can do it. We can bring these Winter Olympics home to Australia and show Australians that we do have a role to play in the world of the Winter Olympics. And I want to put it to you that we should be mounting a campaign, and through you, onto all Australians, that in 2006, we should bring the Winter Olympics to Smiggins Hole. And I've worked out a bit of a play. And I've worked out, I am beginning a march, and I want all Australians to join me from Melbourne up through Buller, up to Smiggins Hole under the banner, bring it home to the hole in 2006. Can it work, Zali? Can we have the Winter Olympics here?
You're going to need a lot of support.
Yes, well, we can get the support if we have every Australian walking on tennis rackets from Melbourne to Smiggins. That could work. You're being asked to help out with the Sydney Olympics, aren't you? That's a summer games, but you're being asked to be an ambassador for the Sydney Olympics.
Well, as a Sydney person, I am in many ways. I mean, competing on the World Cup, we've got footage every week. You know, it's live on TV around the world. And obviously, I'm a bit of an unusual touch to the World Cup by coming from Sydney and in Australia. And so I'm the exotic down under person. And mention is always, you know, Sydney 2000, the Olympics, how's it going? Everyone wants to know. So in that sense, yeah, I'm very much an ambassador. And obviously, as a Sydney sider, I'm not going to be skiing in Sydney, but I'd like to be involved in any way possible.
Are they going to sling you a dollar? Because I noticed years ago, I think Dennis Connor was paid $500,000 just to talk about Australia. Just in passing, whenever he bumped into anyone. Are they offering you an attractive, or a few dollars at least, just to mention Sydney 2000 while you're out and about?
Not yet, but now that you've suggested it to them, you know.
Yeah. They could take that up. They could take that up, couldn't they, Roy?
It's a gravy train, Charlie. You've got to get involved.
Yeah. And get your own tickets. Put your hand up for a few
for
tickets.
For 1,000 tickets?
Yeah.
You could do it.
Now, do you think the Winter Olympics, they're very generous in the family that they include? You know, obviously in the past they've included, bobsled teams from Jamaica and, they've included cross-country skiers from Kenya and so on. And the number of the sports, a lot of the sports are very recent sports, you know, half pipe on the snowboard and so on. Do you think this is fair, or do you think that the sport, you know, I mean, I'm going to enter in the glad bag sliding next year. I think I could probably get that up and running by then.
Well, the moguls. I mean, what's the moguls about? I mean, that just looks stupid to me. There's a way of buggering up your knees, do the muggles.
And your back.
Yes.
But do you think it is too generous in its throw with regard to sports?
No, those sports are all very highly competed sports on the World Cup circuit around the world. I think the Winter Olympics is a growing Olympics in terms that there are a lot of more recent sports, like snowboarding has really grown heaps in the last few years, in sort of last 10 years, and it's just a share of the market and sort of the sporting population that can't be ignored, so you have to include it in the
Olympics. You could argue the same about golf. It's had an enormous following for many years, and yet it's I think it's a demo sport this time around.
What, winter golf? Well, golf on the ski, it'd be bloody hard to find the ball. But there's an idea, golf on skis, it may well work. Speaking of snowboarders, how many of them smoke grass?
Well, I know one personally, since my brother is a snowboarder and was in that.
Does he smoke grass,
and
your brother?
And I'm proud to say he does not. Yeah.
How wild are they, though? They appear to be a rowdy, up yours, plenty of attitude, out of my way, leave my mother alone, you know.
Are they pretty rowdy? They are, but then again, you found rowdy people in every sport. I don't think that's snowboarding alone. I've been to a few football games, and they're all pretty rowdy themselves.
Yes. And now, what are the plans, Zali? Obviously, you'll go back into training for Smiggins in 2006.
I think you started training this week, didn't you? You're back training this week?
Back in training this week, back to the gym and lifting the weights and all that.
And what in preparation for?
Next year, World Cup season, with November till March, and World Championships in February, and obviously the Australian Championships in August this year.
Yes,
where's
right.
that being held? At Smiggins?
Well, Smiggins is usually pad flat, so we'll work on something a little bit steeper.
Yeah.
Niners, can you wish Zali all the very best for a coming workload, and please thank Zali Steggall. I'll
give it up to Zali Steggall story.
You haven't lived till you've stuffed a chook. Call me now for a quick phone pluck. 10-11-69-00-96.
Hey! I'm City from City Olympic Games Motors, and I got some wheels and deals for you. Look, cars! Holden Gordons, Falcons, Utes, wagons for all the family. Just look at those prices, and as my very good friend Joanne says,
the winner is Sydney.
You, Joanne, you see me, Sydney, and twist my arm for a 5-ring gold medal deal at Sydney Olympic Matters.
Monday on The Current Affair, a question of justice.
We, the victims, have lost all our rights.
Is the system too soft on criminals?
He gets different and every day, well,
a special edition, our courts and prisons under the spotlight.
Would you like to confront your son's killers?
Yes, I would.
The death penalty and making lawbreakers serve their time.
They could stay there till they rot.
Have your say in our national phone poll, plus the school with the 100% job guarantee.
Great, because we get prepared for the real world.
The Current Affair.
And now it's time for Come On In, Ray!
There's only one game to play at the business end of the day. It's time for Come On In, Ray! It's Come On In, Ray!
Yes, once again it's time to play Come On In, Ray, this week proudly sponsored by City Olympic Games Motors. And you're going to win fabulous prizes simply by answering the simple question of, when you hear the knocking, is Ray behind door R, door A, or door Y? Roy, who's the lucky contestant this week?
I see we have Kate joining us. Come on, Kate.
Good on you. How are you?
Kate, how are you? Step forward here. Where are you from, Kate?
Ramsgate.
Ramsgate, yeah. When did you come down?
As in...
When did you arrive? Here?
About 8 o'clock.
About 8 o'clock. Have you been having a terrific time?
Yeah.
What did you think of Wayne Goss?
Pretty interesting.
And what did you think of Zali?
Awesome.
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 That's a big rap.
And yeah. How was the water in Ramsgate yesterday? Was it awesome?
Oh, yeah. My TV kept on switching on and off.
Right. Yeah. Did you get any water in the house?
No, I closed the windows.
Closed the windows.
How many inches of rain did you get, Kate?
I don't know. I didn't measure.
Don't you have a little measuring here at the back?
In the flats.
Right.
On the first flat, so it didn't get me.
Listen, are you prepared to take the challenge?
Yep.
You understand there are three doors. You've got to pick the one that you think Ray is behind. And the audience can help by shouting out encouragement.
Yes.
Once you hear the knock, Kate, once you hear the knock, you have a lash. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Let's have the knock. All right, off you shoot. R, A, or Y? Yes!
Yes!
Congratulations! And here, yes, Kerri-Ann Kennelly. You've done extremely well, Kate.
Now, Kate, because you've won, there's a magnificent offering here. Can you bring in the Munro of meat, Ian Terpstrappy? Something Easter special-wise, Kate, here. Roy, take us through the Munro. What's on it?
Look, there's tremendous stuff here, Kate. And can I say, because of we were here at Channel 9 hit by lightning yesterday and the fridge broke down, so all this meat is off. However, we'll replace it with exactly the same style of meat once the fridges are fixed, okay? Yes. So you won't be taking this home. I know the smell's driving you crazy. Well, you can take it home if you like.
I'll take it home.
And give it to some friends. Okay, give it a go.
Here's the apron. Yours to keep, Kate. And now, Roy, produce the implements.
Here we are. You've got this. You've got that. And you'll have 9 seconds to gather as much material as you can to put into this bowl to take home for your friends at Ramsgate. You have to use that. You can use that and your hands. I don't mind. Use whatever you like. We only give you this as assistance, okay? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. 1, 2, 3.
5 seconds of lead action.
What have you got here?
Now, who've you come with tonight, too?
Them two.
And are you going to barbecue this up tomorrow?
No, they're going to do it.
They're going to do it. That's going to be beautiful.
You've got the meat, they cook it.
Yes, you've got the meat, they cook it. You've got some sausages there. You didn't get any mince. Let's give you a little bit of mince to go with.
A couple of hamburgers.
There you go.
I shouldn't have done that because that's going to give people a bit of an idea of what they can do next week by lifting things up. We'll have to weld those down by next week. Okay, well done. You also get...
Plus the Come On In, Ray game. It's a tremendous game. You have all the fun of what you've had tonight here on the Channel 9 show.
You're covering it up there, Kate. We get a photograph. Come on, let's all get involved.
There you go.
Okay, take that away with you. I'll leave that on the beat. Kate. Congratulations and well done, Lynn. Come on in, Ray.
Unfortunately, it's time to come to the end of another Channel 9 show for this week. Roy, look, we do have something for the Niners out there. Look, that snap we had up last week of
Richo
on the job.
Mouthing off.
Just went off like hotcakes.
Yeah, we sold them all.
We sold the 50,000. And this week, Roy, what have we got?
We've got a wonderful photograph, HG, an artistic photograph of George Negus on the set of the show on the ABC television. Our foreign correspondent. It's simply called You Could Be Forgiven for Thinking. There's George. It's beautifully framed. If you wish to purchase it, phone now. Our lines are available. We do have staff waiting there for your call. It's $49.99 unframed, $499.99 framed. I suggest you get it framed because it really is a beautiful piece of work and it'll look very, very attractive in any games room.
Yes, it would. And how many of these have we done, Roy? Are we up over the 75?
We've got 75,000 of these ready to go, 50,000 of which are framed. So if you get in early enough, you might be able to buy a couple.
Roy, what will you be doing over the next set of seven or this weekend? Of course, a big weekend, Easter weekend.
It is a big weekend. Yes. It's Easter, actually. It's my Uncle Ray's birthday, so I'll be going to spend a bit of time with my Uncle Ray tomorrow, and I'm going to give him four framed photographs.
Yeah, is he a Negus freak?
He's a Negus freak, so you can have George in every room in which he goes. I'll be going to the Royal Easter Show, obviously, and then I'll be joining your birthday bash.
Oh, well, that's tremendous. Good to have you on board down in Adelaide, and now as the bunny begins to make his drops around the nation, we leave you with Signed, Sealed and Delivered, presented this evening by Peter Andre! What? See you next week, Niners!
I went and stayed too long. Now I'm wondering if love's still strong. Ooh, baby, here I am, signed, sealed, delivered, I'm yours. Hey. In that time I went and said goodbye. Now I'm back and not ashamed to cry. Ooh, baby, here I am, signed, sealed, delivered, I'm yours.
If you'd like to be in the audience for the